London Transport runs more than 6,600 buses and carries 4 million passengers a day. To provide that service, they employ more than 25,000 people. These statistics help make London Transport the biggest urban passenger network in the world. The man in charge of running London's buses is David Hornby. He controls a budget of nearly £250 million. But last year there was a deficit of £20 million, in spite of a £66 million subsidy from the Greater London Council. Tonight on Thames Report, passengers get the chance to question David Hornby on the price and standard of the service he provides. And we're holding our discussion here in the boardroom of London Transport. And first of all, let's get a comment from our audience about the level of fares and the increases we've had. Tony Blackburn, chairman of the London Passenger Action Confederation. I think you wanted to make a comment about that.
Well, it's disgraceful. We've now had fares rises of 200% over the last 4 years, and we're getting a worse service on the buses. Fares are now leading inflation, not following it. I'd like to know why Dr. Hornby thinks he can get away with charging this excessive fares for a very poor service on the buses, which is getting worse.
I can understand why people are concerned about the fares increases. They've just gone up. But I think we should put the 200% that you mentioned over 4 years into the perspective of the enormous inflation that's been over that period. I really don't think bus fares are wildly out of line with the prices of other things that have gone up over the years. But you also said that the service is getting worse. In fact, over the last 3 months, the bus services have started to get better. We know that during last year, we reached a pretty low point, but in the last 2 or 3 months, things have started to get better.
Well, I'd like to move it on to the question of the standard of service in a moment, but Mr. Blackburn, you said 200%, I think, over the last four years. I mean, that surely is well over the rate of inflation, isn't it, Dr. Hornby?
Well, I don't have the figures with me, unfortunately, but certainly I believe that prices have gone up about three times since the middle of the 1970s.
But are you saying it's simply because of inflation? That's the only reason for the increase we've had in bus fares?
Well, I'm saying that we run an operation where we have to buy fuel, where we have to buy spare parts and materials for our buses, and where we have to pay our staff. And in order to recruit our staff, we have to pay a competitive wage for them, and indeed they deserve it. And like everybody else, if we're going to stay in business, we've got to pay the sort of wages to attract people to come and work for us.
Does anybody else want to make a point about that? Andrew McIntosh.
Well, it is also fair to say that the money coming from the ratepayers and taxpayers in the form of grant from the GLC has gone down in real terms over those last two, three years, and therefore the amount of the money that has to come from the fares must go up.
So you're of course the Labour spokesman on these matters, and we've got next to you your Conservative colleague, Alan Greengross.
Whilst Andrew might well say it's fair to say, it wouldn't be true to say. The fact is that if you take all the monies that the GLC has put into London Transport and you compare 1977 with 1979, in real terms, and that's all that matters, I mean, forgetting inflation, in real terms, the total amount of money that the GLC has put in has actually increased by 9% in those 2 years.
Do you think it's satisfactory just to say that it's inflation that's to blame for these fare increases?
Not totally, although inflation obviously has a big part to play. It's a very labour-intensive industry, and in a situation where wages tend to rise faster than prices, you will always get an accentuation of the inflationary spiral. But over and above this, I mean, it is a reflection of the problems that London Transport faces and the fact that we have got to bring ourselves into the 1980s, but firmly into the 1980s.
Well, in a moment, later on in the programme, we'd like to talk about what possible remedies there are to improving service and so on, but can I have some comments on the level of service at the moment? Now, Emily Braidwood, I think you're from Peckham, and I think you wanted to say something about the standard of the service in your area.
Yes, I'm a housewife, and I've got this grinding despair about the 63 bus route and the 21. Now, would you believe that I've had this terrible experience with the 21 bus when I've had to take my four small children to Guy's? Things came to head for me when I realised a round bus journey took me 3 hours, that's to go to Guy's and back. But when my boys were small, I had to take them to London Bridge for this dental checkup. I wrote my letter complaining. I had a reply from the Department of Transport and also the Executive Broadway, and they agree that this problem has been with them for 20 years. They agree there is this terrible congestion along the Old Kent Road and at New Cross. Why should it take 20 years to resolve this problem?
Well, let's get, before we have a specific answer on that, let's get one or two other points. Yes, a gentleman there in the third row. Yes, you've got a point to make?
Charles Hawkins, Harrow Public Transport Users Association. I'd like to make one comment on the flat fare system introduced in Harrow, and I'd like to ask Dr. Cornby two questions on it.
Can we perhaps come to that later? What we're looking for now is comments on the standard of the service that the buses offer. Now, have you got anything to say about that?
Well, I think what most people require is reliability in service. And in Harrow, we've had a very, very bad time on buses not turning up. And waits of half an hour and an hour are not infrequent on some of the services.
Anyone else? Yes, a gentleman there in the second row.
Can you tell me
can
why...
Can you give us your name?
Duxbury, Ivor Duxbury. Why is it that you have put a private bus operator down in Feltham, which runs every day till 7 o'clock at night? He runs on Saturday, but he doesn't run on Sunday. Now, does the London Transport think that we're living out in mud huts down in Feltham?
Can I move it on to any comments about the standard of the service that London Transport itself offers? Yes, a lady on the back row there.
My name is Joan Trimmingham, and I'm an employee of Guest Detners Manufacturing Limited.
Whereabouts is that?
Tottenham, N17. I've been working at Guest Detner for the past 3 years, and I've taken the 123 bus from Wood Green to Tottenham each morning for 5 days a week. And it's disgusting, because if I do not leave about 7:10 in the mornings, I won't get a bus to work for 8 o'clock.
Right. Well, let's give Dr. Cornby an answer now. We've had four comments there about the standard of the service. What would you like to say to those comments?
Well, I use the buses myself, and I share the frustrations that you who use the buses do too, though it isn't bad all the time, as I think most people would be prepared to admit. Indeed, it's been bad rather less of the time recently. Now, on the 63s, for instance, they come out of Peckham Garage, and we have had some difficulties at Peckham Garage, particularly with the kinds of bus that we operate on the 63 route. Now, in the course of the last week or two, we have changed the type of bus that we operate on some of the other routes out of Peckham. And the result is that today, for instance, all the buses at Peckham were available for service. And that is a very different picture from what it was 2 or 3 months ago. Now, we can put all the buses out on the road, but you quite rightly say that if they get jammed up in traffic on the Elkent Road, and that's the direction I come in to work from as well, so I know what it's like, there's very little we can do about that.
And but isn't it in fact the case that only, I think, 1/8 of the mileage that's lost is through traffic congestion?
There are three factors that cause scheduled mileage to be lost and services to become irregular. One is staff, one is lack of buses, and one is traffic congestion on the road.
According to the figures I've seen, the traffic congestion is only 1/8 of the
mileage lost. No, the actual mileage, the scheduled mileage that we lose because a bus is delayed and has to be turned short, is a small proportion of the total. But when we lose part of the service because of traffic problems, it is because it's disrupting a lot of other services as well, which don't lose mileage but simply run irregularly. And if you take account of that fact, then the relative importance of traffic, staff, and non-availability of buses last year was about the same. In fact, traffic was slightly worse. This year, traffic is going to be the dominant factor, there's no doubt about that, because we have largely solved our vehicle availability problem.
Roger Hiskey from Lewisham, I think you wanted to
thank you very much. Yes, I'm a supporter of the Lewisham campaign to improve public transport, and I was a member of the GLC. Now, when I was a member of the GLC, I rang up your 8 district bus managers and got figures for 3 days of the number of buses that were supposed to be running and the number of buses that actually ran. Now, we talk about Peckham. Peckham Garage, over those 3 days, had a 26%, a quarter of the buses not running. Catford nearby was 19%, New Cross nearby was 22%. Now, do you know, Dr. Cornby, when I went down to Peckham Garage, then as a GLC member, there were 15 inspection pits at Peckham Bus Garage, which London ratepayers and taxpayers have financed. 2 engineers working there. It was a Sunday, I admit, but 15 inspection pits, 2 engineers working there, and yet on the Monday, 26% of the buses not running. Indeed, on a Monday, the Monday we went down there with a Thames television crew, and there was nobody working on those inspection pits. Now, I put it to you, And I ask you, Dr. Quarmby, there's a lack of urgency within our bus garages in London to get the service more reliable.
Mr. Hiskey, you quite rightly say that the first day you went there was a Sunday. We don't bring all our staff to work in over Sunday. It would be very expensive to do so, and it is not necessary to do so. Secondly, I hope you heard me say a few moments ago, Peckham had all their buses available for service today. We have made the dramatic improvement in bus availability that we promised we would, and we have achieved it at Peckham, and I'd be glad if you would recognise the fact. The further point is, you said you took a Thames television crew down there on the Monday and filmed there, and there wasn't work going on. Indeed there wasn't, because the crews asked if the engineering work could stop because they were making too much noise.
Can I come back, please, Dr. Quarmby, on that very quickly? And I would say this, I don't believe, in fact, that was the case, but I would put this to you, Dr. Quarmby, that the whole emphasis of London Transport is to put attention on the results of bus districts. You know, for example, Selkent, the district for that area. When you start focusing public attention on a garage-by-garage basis and start looking on a garage-by-garage basis that the bus is not available, you get an entirely different picture. Wouldn't it be a good thing to make individual garages publish, say, on a monthly basis, the percentage of buses that were supposed to be running that didn't run from those garages?
Well, I don't know whether this is the course you wish the discussion to take.
Well, I think we could have an answer to that, couldn't we? I mean, is that a sensible suggestion?
It has been our practice so far not to publish individual garage figures because I believe it would be invidious for the managers and the supervisors at those garages. It is true that we have concentrated on the district performance because the district is the level of management that we have increased recently. Indeed, we have two district managers present here today. And I think that if we can hear how their performance has improved, I think we'd be very pleased with the new management setup that we've got.
Well, there we are. Let's break off our discussion here for a moment. We've had some discussion of what people feel is wrong on the buses. But earlier I spoke to the leader of the Greater London Council, Sir Horace Cutler, to find out how he felt about London's bus services.
I feel the bus service is very bad. It's inefficient, unreliable. I think from a public sense, it is unacceptable, and something has to be done about that.
Whose fault is it that it's unacceptable?
There's several reasons. There's congestion on the roads, mechanical defects, staff problems, which have been well documented. But in the statutory sense, you see, the GLC is responsible for the overall policy and financial control. And power and responsible, not responsible for the day-to-day running of it. And we seem to get the responsibility for the day-to-day running, of which we have none, and we haven't got the power to alter that in the statutory sense. It needs looking at.
So are you saying that it's the management of London Transport's fault?
It's a managerial job, yes, entirely.
So it's their fault that the service is unacceptable?
It is their problem, to put it straight.
What do you feel about the claims made that perhaps £50 million of money could be saved simply if London Transport was run efficiently?
Well, that's Leslie Chapman's report, or part of it, his allegation. I thought there was sufficient substance in it for us to warrant an inquiry from London Transport on the specific issues, and we've asked them, and they'll be reporting at the end of this month on that. I think there's room for great economies there.
You think there is evidence of some waste, which is what he was talking about?
If there hadn't been evidence of that, then we wouldn't have pursued the inquiries.
Do you feel it's right that London Transport should continue to have a monopoly of the bus services in London?
I'm not sure. And it's an interesting situation now because you've got a new transport bill going through which lifts the monopoly of London Transport to run the services in London. We've broken the bus service down into 8 districts, so we'll have comparative results both in revenue and efficiency. It might be considered later on, if you get 2 or 3 districts who are unable to come up to scratch, that is acceptability and efficiency, of bringing in the private operator. I remember in London, of course, the pirate buses in the 20s. I used to catch one. I used to hare down the high street at Tottenham, Stamford Hill. Wonderful service.
Worth trying again, you think?
Possibly.
Well, we'll return to that suggestion of the possibility of bringing in private enterprise to run the buses in a moment. But first of all, I'd like to pick up the other point that Sir Horace Cutler was making there, David Quarmby. Do you think that it's right that there is a substantial amount of money being wasted in London Transport at the moment that could be channeled into providing a better bus service?
I think it would be surprising if, in an organisation of the size of LT, it was impossible to find some waste somewhere. I personally, and certainly the executive, don't believe that there is waste on the scale being that was alleged by Mr. Chapman, and indeed the report of the auditors that was put in also agreed with us that there wasn't evidence of waste of that extent.
No, but I think they suggested there was some suspicion, didn't they? I mean, I think what they said was that it would take a long investigation to establish the evidence, but they certainly seem to sympathise with a good many of Mr. Chapman's conclusions.
Well, I don't really want to get drawn on this now. The GLC has asked the executive to make a report on the report of the auditors, and we have undertaken to do so by the end of March.
I mean, for example, I quote from the auditor's report, London Transport agrees that for historical reasons it is too bureaucratic. It talks of senior staff increasing from 140 to 380 over nearly 30 years, while the number of bus passenger miles has fallen by more than half. I mean, that does suggest, doesn't it, that something's gone wrong in the organisation. There are, if you like, too many passengers inside London Transport and too few being carried on the buses.
I really feel you ought to have the chairman here to be addressing those questions to. I'm responsible for the bus operation in LT, the bus business. There are whole swathes of London Transport that, frankly, I'm not responsible for, and it wouldn't be fair for me to speak to. Now, if you talk about the bus side, we have increased the number of managers as part of our reorganisation. That is something I was determined to do because, frankly, I felt that the bus side of LT was undermanaged. And I think the success with which our district management teams have addressed themselves to the task and have made noticeable and dramatic improvements in the bus service in the 3 or 4 months since they came in demonstrates to me that it was the right thing to do.
We're getting rumblings in the second row there. Did someone want to come in there?
There's no improvements. I mean, these bus districts, they're just cosmetics.
Well, we're going to come...
It's another tier, another person to have to complain to. Why does it take 3 months to answer a letter of complaint to 55 Broadway, Dr. Cornby?
Mr. Blackman, I don't know when you last wrote a letter to complain about the bus services, but we have posters all over London asking you to write to your district manager, and he will answer it an awful lot quicker than three months.
But not a satisfactory answer.
Has anybody else got any views about the new district manager system?
Well, we have two of them there.
Well, we'll come to those in a minute. There's a lady sitting behind Mr. Blackburn there.
It's Mrs. Ray, West Hampstead Amenity and Transport. And the thing about this district thing, when it all started off, we got great fanfares of publicity, and this is your district, and pieces in the local paper about your friendly bus manager. But it just so happens that my local buses, there are three totally separate district buses running through it. So who do I complain to? Watling, Leaside, or Abbey? Do I write to Mr. Cohn and expect him to pass it on to Watling District? I mean, what is it purely a PR exercise just designed to stop people?
That's right.
You got much better sense when you wrote 255 Broadway to the PR department than writing to a...
After 3 months.
Yeah, well, 3 months, but it might take well, 6 months.
Is it a PR exercise?
No,
Dr.
it
Corbett?
Certainly is not a PR exercise. I mean, gosh, I wouldn't be doing it if it was just a PR exercise. I took over...
Tell me how it works, then, please.
Well, could I ask two of the district managers present here to tell you how it works, and then I'll tell you what benefit they've achieved.
Well, can't you tell us yourself, sir?
Well, of course I can, but we are in... I'm trying to delegate and devolve away from the 55 Broadway.
Well, let's hear from one of our district managers to what they've achieved in the months since they've been working.
Brewer, I'm the district manager Forest in Outer East London. It's nonsense for Mr. Blackburn to say it's cosmetics. As far as public correspondence is concerned, I'm able to clear letters within a matter of weeks rather than months. Certainly...
Weeks?
Yes, a few weeks, and I personally see all the service complaints.
Apart from answering complaints, have you managed to improve the service there?
Well, we certainly
have indeed. In fact, when I took over, about 80 of the 700 buses or so were unable to leave the garage each morning because they were mechanically unfit. This morning's figure was 10. Now, that represents an improvement of 11%. And, in fact, I've received a number of commendations from my customers saying that the service has, in fact, improved.
It's interesting. I was given some figures about the improvement that's been introduced on the since you brought the district managers in. But it's interesting to note that even now, with district managers, in some areas, it's only sort of just over 80% of scheduled mileage that's run. I mean, that suggests that it's been a pretty much a pinprick exercise, hasn't it?
No, not at all. You see, as I've already explained, some of the problems we have in running the bus service are down to us as management to do the best job we can, particularly the engineering side. Bus availability, training of staff, all those things are within our responsibility. And those are the areas where we've made the improvement. However, there are still some things which we cannot totally influence ourselves. Staff shortage and traffic on the road. Now, those garages and those areas which are only producing about 80 to 85% of the service, they tend to be those garages, those areas with the highest staff shortage. Stockwell Garage, for instance, has about a 20% staff shortage. Now, with the best will in the world there, the local manager and the Abbey district manager cannot produce people out of thin air.
We've got a driver and a conductor in the audience. It would be interesting to hear from them whether they feel the district system has improved the efficiency of the service that they're working on. Either of you anything to say about that?
Well, conductor Sheldrick Hackney, one of the better garages, naturally. The problem is staff. One of the main problems is staff.
What, now, not enough staff, you
staff
mean?
Retention. Staff recruitment is easier than staff retention. Staff retention is difficult because once they get in the garage and once they start their duties, they find how arduous they are. A five-day week is advertised and a seven-day week is worked. You start a late turn on a Thursday and you work through to a Wednesday, which is 7 days in anyone's book.
But the key point here, can I just interrupt you? The key point here was we're being told by London Transport that the district system is improving things. Now, what I'd like to know is whether you feel that it is.
Staff-wise, the district system does nothing for staff whatsoever. They do their job in their way. I'm not criticising district at all. I'm mentioning the subject of staff retention. Once you recruit, you want to keep these fellas.
Do you feel
you can't keep them if you can't give them a decent job?
Do you feel that there are too many chiefs and not enough Indians at London Transport, as Mr Chapman's report seems to suggest?
That applies in all industry, not particularly London Transport, all industry. But I will say this, that the only way to retain good staff in London Transport is to give them a good working condition. And a seven-day week is not good working condition. Nor is working on a bus for 8 hours on a trot, a job that I'm doing currently, that is not conducive to staff retention.
But the problem is that I imagine the consumers here feel that they need a bus service 7 days a week, don't they?
Well, I'm getting without staff.
Lady there in the fourth row.
Yes, my name is Jo Milbank. I'm from the Lewisham Campaign to Improve Public Transport. We were formed over a year ago to look into the very problems we're discussing here now. And in fact, as you say, we have found in our area some of the users, who people that live and work, have found that there have been a very, very slight improvement. But the situation still remains, there are not enough buses on the road. I personally work with various people from local communities, and they're waiting at bus stops for a long, long time.
Can I just ask you, though, what do you feel about weekend buses? Because this is something where plans were put forward, proposals were put forward to reduce the weekend service.
Well, I think that just shows that our bus service is not seen as a public service, and we think it is a very vital social service to all the people who live in London.
So do we.
We ask the GLC and the London Transport to acknowledge this.
Well, we certainly do.
But isn't that the point, that the response seems to be, if there's a difficulty, either put up the fares or cut the service back?
Yes. Yeah. That's right.
There's been a misunderstanding about the two-part weekend scheduling proposals that we've spoken of before, and we've put to the GLC. I'm sorry?
They are not cut.
They will not cut the service.
But that's what you said about primary scheduling, and that cut the service.
Well, hang on.
Can you explain how, because
what it seems to be is that you cut it back by a quarter on a Saturday and a third on a Sunday, isn't it?
No, or the other way around.
Not as much as that.
We have said that there are many places, many garages, which, for reasons of staff shortage, are only able to put out about 80, 85% of the service. During the week particularly, they manage to provide better coverage these days at the weekend, because there isn't the traffic problem, because it's not using all the vehicles, so any vehicle shortage doesn't show up in quite the same way. And most people travel during the week. It's when most people travel to work. It is the period of the week when we get the most complaints from passengers. So at the request of the GLC, who directed us to put forward proposals to improve the reliability of the service by the 1st of June, as it happened, but we couldn't meet that date, and we told them why. Our proposals are to shift a small amount of the resources, the operation, from the weekend to the week, to balance up the kind of quality that we can provide as between the weekday
you're
and the weekend.
You're not putting any more buses on the road on the weekday than on the weekends, are you?
We are. I'm sorry. I'm telling you that there are some parts of London where we are not providing a full service during the week, and we are providing a full service almost at the weekend.
By cutting them at the weekend, you're not putting them on the road during the week. It's nonsense.
Is it nonsense?
I don't know where I'm getting to with this discussion with Mr. Blackburn. I'm telling him that there are many places where we are not operating a full service during the week,
I'm telling you that by cutting them onto the weekends as well, they're the same.
What about the I'm sorry, I'm talking about how we use the people, the staff, Mr. Sheldrick.
Can I perhaps break in here? Because it seems to me that what people are saying is that there does appear to be this reflex that if there is a difficulty of some kind, the solution is either you have to get more money from the rates, or you have to get more money from the fares, or you have to cut the service back.
There is no such reflex at all. This year, we are having to run our services with less, slightly less expenditure than last year. It's not totally imposed on us by the GLC. It's part of the disciplines we've imposed on ourselves and the times in which we live. And this year, we are going to run more service than last year. Now, I don't call that just an automatic reflex in the face of a problem.
But last year, I think, was the lowest number, lowest amount of bus mileage ever run, I think, by
yes,
London Transport,
was.
Wasn't it?
Yes, it was.
Yes, Mr. McLeod, you're from the official London Transport Passenger Committee.
Yes. In October, we did a survey. My committee stood around bus stops, and the result of that survey showed that 25, a quarter of the buses were not running on that day. And this seems to be quite typical. And the answer I was given was, districts will help to solve the problem. Now, my committee is doing another survey on exactly the same routes in the spring. We look forward to seeing an improvement. But can I pick up one point that was made by this audience, which I think could be very valuable? The responsibility, we have been told, we understand, is devolved to districts. I think, and my committee has reason to believe, that there are good garages and there are bad garages. And I think there are a number of bad garages which are hiding behind the good ones.
Well, this is a point that Mr. Hiskey made earlier, isn't it?
Yes,
I don't know whether you want to reply briefly.
I do agree with him
that.
On this point. I think that my committee will almost certainly be pressing for information to winkle out the garages that are not delivering.
Yes, I don't know
what Mr. McLeod thinks he's going to do with the information he winkles out about those garages whose performance is less good than others. It is largely down to management, which is what our district management is all about.
And there's
evidence, considerable evidence, that the performance
Dr.
of the garages...
Dr. you to say that, it's, that nobody
can,
should
can
know
I, I'm sorry, Mr. McLeod, I'll have to interrupt you. I want to mention one point very quickly.
Yes.
Sir Horace Cutler mentioned the prospect of bringing in private enterprise. Very briefly, what do you think of that possibility?
Well, people have this feeling that there is a complete monopoly by LT in Greater London at the moment. There is not. There are already over a dozen operators providing nearly 90 independent bus services already throughout London. One gentleman mentioned one of them and said it didn't provide a Sunday service.
That's right.
Well,
cheap labour.
That's
cheap labour.
You can draw your conclusions as you will from
the driver
that.
Told me himself, starvation wages.
Well,
they are not our responsibility.
Well, he just stumbles. He played with the.
Let's go back to Councillor Greengross there, who's been listening very patiently to this. What's your feeling, having heard this discussion this evening? Lots of points raised. What do you feel that the GLC and London Transport might learn from the points that have been raised this evening?
I think that GLC and London Transport both have a very clear role to play. As Sir Horace was saying earlier on, our role is to define an overall policy, to set minimum standards, and to provide the money so that that service is bought for the people of London. Now, that's our side of the contract. LT's side of the contract, within those constraints, is to offer the best possible service that can be offered. Now, I believe that we've got a long way to go, but I do believe that we're beginning to travel in the right direction.
Let's hope those are words of hope, then, from Councillor Greengross. We'll no doubt carry on with our discussion here in the audience for some time to come, because lots of people want to raise questions. But from the special edition of Thames Report now, it's good night. Well done. We might try...